And welcome back to the show. TJ Smith here, and I am pleased to be joined by Orioles Hall of Famer and broadcaster Jim Palmer. A very good afternoon to you, sir. Thanks for joining me.
It is afternoon. Yeah, where you're probably in a dark room somewhere.
Yeah, so, we made it through.
Yeah, I know. Well, they hide. I hide out sometimes too.
Yeah,
I look better in a dark room.
Indeed. Anyway, how you doing? I'm well, but thank you very much for joining me today, and always enjoy hearing your commentary on Orioles games. It's almost like you know what's coming up next as far as the next pitch. And as a pitcher, I saw this on the National Baseball Hall of Fame and Museum Twitter yesterday. It says, just 4 days after returning from a torn lower back muscle, Jim Palmer threw a no-hitter for the Orioles on this date, which would be yesterday, in 1969, his eighth of 11 consecutive victories. And the reason I wanted to bring that up off the top, how concerned should Orioles fans be for Grayson Rodriguez? I believe this is like a lower back injury, not what you suffered, but how concerned are we with that? And what do you see in this young man as far as the future for him? Because he seems to have figured it out.
Yeah, I don't know if we ever really figured it out, but I think he's certainly going in the right direction. He's the last really high draft choice, you know, a little different regime. Mike Elias came over in 2019, but Dan Duquette, they drafted Grayson in 2018, number one, you know, I think it was the 11th pick that year out of Texas. You know, great arm, you know, can throw anywhere from 96 to 99. Good split, you know, good curveball, slider. I mean, the pandemic didn't do him any good because didn't get as many innings as he normally would have in 2020. Then he had the same injury that he has now. In talking to him the other day, he said he doesn't think it's as severe, and that's the lat injury. That's one of the biggest muscles in your back. And, you know, again, I think because, what, he's 24 years old. I mean, he's got 13 wins. I mean, the Orioles, you know, to be quite honest, I mean, they've already, let's see, they lost Bradish, they lost Wells, they lost Means, they lost Coulomb, they lost Batista, who's the best reliever in the American League. Now, Jacob Webb is out with an elbow injury, you know, maybe tendonitis, hopefully, so they can maybe inject it, you know, take care of that. So when you lose something like Grayson, and, you know, you got Corbin Burns, you gave up a couple of really good players for him. He was the number one guy, you know, he's in the Cy Young race. You know, Grayson's a big part of this, but you know, the injuries, contrary to, you know, you talked about the back injury I had, I was pitching well. I think I was 10-2, and my injury was basically my left leg was a little bit shorter until I actually found a doctor, the team doctor in Detroit. He was also the AA wrestling or weightlifting doctor. He was an osteopath. He said, put a lift in your shoe. But it took me 52 days to find that guy. And then I came back. I pitched six shutout innings against the Twins, who had, you know, Killebrew and Oliva that are in the Hall of Fame. And then my next start was the no-hitter against the Oakland A's. In fact, Brett Hollander said, how many pitches did you throw? And I said, I threw 169 in the playoff game, 171 in the World Series game. It had to be in that number. Mm. But back then, they counted the pitches, but they didn't really care.
I'm glad you brought that up because I wanted to ask you about that. I've heard you over the years bring up pitch count. Do you think baseball is too conservative? Again, audience, we're speaking to Orioles broadcaster and Hall of Famer Jim Palmer. Do you think that we've gotten way too much into some of the analytics? I mean, again, you think of all of these guys that are out for Tommy John they're on pitch counts. Do you think they could go 150, 160, 170 pitches today?
Well, they don't need to do that, but I think that they could probably pitch a little bit more than, you know, than what they've been pitching. But what's interesting, I ended up going down to Canton and going to the gym, but I started my scorecard for tonight's game. And, you know, Dean Kramer, hopefully he'll pitch well. He pitched great last year, beat the Nats 1-0. But they have a young pitcher for the Nats, DJ Hurst. You know, hard-throwing lefty, only 23. But if you're Dave Martinez or you're Jim Hickey, their pitching coach, they're going to look at his numbers. So, you know, I'm right now I'm on StatCast, and if I go to his pitching, and he'll tell me, you know, he's given up 49 hits in 49 innings. He struck out 63, which is a really good number. Only walked 17. Now he throws 18.2 pitches per innings. Start doing the math.
Mm-hmm.
5 innings pitches. You know, and then you throw another 18 pitches, you're at 108. Now you'd think when you only pitch every fifth day, you know, 108 would be no big deal. I mean, you know, you used to do it in your sleep in the old days. But what the number, the important number to look at is, what do you do the first time through the lineup? What do you do the second time if you're a starting pitcher? And probably more importantly, what do you do the third time? So if you look at Jay Hurst, who, again, I mean, he's only 2-4. You know, he's a young pitcher. First time through the lineup, 195. The second time, you know, the hitters get to see him for the second time, batting average goes to 242. The third time, and again, he's young, 23, they're 10-for-18 with 3 home runs and 5 RBIs.
Yeah.
So now, if you're Dave Martinez or you're Jim Hickey, the pitching coach for the Nats, you're going, okay, and that's, you know, that's probably right around 75 to 90 pitches. Bullpen gets up. The analytical guys, and it doesn't answer all your questions, but the analytical guys are saying, hey, we have better guys in the bullpen than what DJ Hurst is going to be the third time through the order.
Right.
So what do they do? They go to the bullpen. And that's kind of what happens. Now, the question is, you pitch every fifth day. You got 4 trainers. You got massage guys. You got strength guys. You can work out all winter because you make a lot more than most of the guys in my era. In fact, all the guys in my era. Why can't you get a guy out 3 times?
Mm. Yeah.
You got all the tools. Yeah. Tell you what the axis is on your slider. You know, what the backspin is on your fastball. You know, whether your release point's the same. But just think about it. When if you were pitching for any team, especially the Orioles, the first pitch in spring training that you threw in the bullpen, they would have a guy, a TrackMan or a Rapsodo camera. It would go on a computer, and that would go to the front office.
Yeah.
Now, they didn't do that in my year. I mean, what mattered was after 6 or 7 starts in probably 40-some innings in spring training, could you throw 115 to 120 pitches? Could you go down, pitch 7 innings, and then go pitch the 8th and 9th in the bullpen so you could pitch extra innings on opening day? And that's the way we train. So I understand you're trying to protect your investments. But to your point, they keep throwing less and they get paid more for less, and they keep getting hurt. And that's a problem for Major League Baseball.
Yeah, again, we're speaking to the Orioles Hall of Famer Jim Palmer, also a broadcaster. So I saw this last night from Ken Rosenthal, and they talked to Zach Eflin's coach from the Rays. Let me know, is this normal or is this something different where Zach Eflin's coach was in touch with the Orioles, with their staff saying what he was working on with them, and is still in touch with Eflin? What do you think about that? It's interdivision rivalry, but the relationship that this person had with his pitcher, and he kind of wants to see him flourish. Is that something that you've heard before? Is this normal? Is this an anomaly?
Well, you know, I think what makes it, and I read the article yesterday. First of all, you got to understand. I mean, I met Eflin for the first time yesterday.
Mm-hmm.
And I told him, I said, you're a little bit old school. And he said, what do you mean? I said, well, you know how to pitch. It's not always about maximum velocity. It's about moving the ball around in the strike zone. You know, being able to pitch to both sides of the plate, up and down. You know, he's got a cutter, which I didn't have. I had more of a slider, curveball, changeup, along with 2 fastballs. But he knows how to pitch. He's 6'6". He uses his height well. But, you know, I mean, I had one of the great pitching coaches of all time, George Bamberger. That was something that George would have done because he cared about us. You know, he went on to manage Milwaukee and the Mets. But Kyle Snyder is a class guy, and that's the pitching coach you're talking about for the Tampa Bay Rays. And you have to also understand, you know, the Rays won 99 games last year. They started out 30-9. He was a big part of that. Talking about Zach Eflin. So when you lose a guy, you know, number one, you usually don't trade a type of guy like that to a division rival. But, you know, the Orioles and the Rays are kind of small market teams in this, you know, in this pond, the American League East. You know, Red Sox spend a lot more money. Yankees are spending over $300 million. The Reds, you know, the Rays and the Orioles are more small market. And so I still think you want to make the best trade you can make. So, you know, Zach had a lot of value. And, you know, and I think, again, it just it speaks volumes to what kind of guy Kyle Snyder is. And, again, you have, you know, whether it's a hitting instructor, you know, Terry Crowley, you know, one of the great hitting instructors, one of my teammates is getting into the Hall of Fame. If you had Crow as your hitting instructor, you never forget how instrumental he was or coaches are in allowing you to be the best player you can be. And I think, you know, Kyle Snyder understood and wanted to thank Zach Eflin for the contribution he made last year in a 99-win team with that lost three guys to Tommy John surgery, just like the Orioles had this year. So it's a class move. You don't, to your point, you don't see it a whole lot. But, boy, don't you like to see that? And that's kind of the way the world that's the way we should, you know, again, if you have differences or a guy gets traded, you still want to look out for him. And, you know, it's great to see that happen.
Yeah, again, speaking with Jim Palmer, Orioles Hall of Famer and broadcaster, as we wrap up here, I wanted to ask, we're in a playoff push and the hunt for October is on. What do you see, a two-parter here, as the biggest challenges in front of us to finish number one in whether it be baseball, our division or what have you, to get through the playoffs? And what do you look at as well as our biggest advantages over some of the other teams?
Well, the biggest advantage is they won 101 games last year, so most of the players know what it takes to win. Now, with that said, you know, the Orioles, small market club, you know, $30 million payroll higher than last year because of arbitration, but all kinds of injuries. This is not the same team. You know, they're 70-50, so they're 20 games over 500. In the last 36 games, they haven't even been able to play 500 ball. Now, it doesn't mean they're not playing hard. Doesn't mean they haven't made trades to try to get better, something Mike Elias did. But at the end of the day, when you lose three starters, you know, your best left-hander. You know, Danny Coulomb, his whip, that's walks and hits per innings, were 0.67. So that means the walks and hits he gave up in an inning were less than one. I mean, and if you're less than one, you're having a great year. 0-16 with runners in scoring position. So you lose him, the bone chips. Hopefully he'll be back in September, but there's no guarantee. You know, you lose, as you mentioned, Grayson Rodriguez, 13-game winner. You lose Means, who pitched the no-hitter. You lose Bradish, who was the fourth-best pitcher in the American League last year. Every time he pitched, he was as good as anybody else on the other team. So you lose that. You lose Tyler Wells, who last year had the lowest walks and hits per nine innings of any pitcher in the American League the first half. You know, now he did have trouble staying healthy. He had to have Tommy John. So this is a club that's wounded. You got Jordan Westberg, you know, a young player that could play third, could play second, hit 18 home runs. He'll be out till the end of September probably because of a broken hand. So this is not the same team. Now, you got a guy that's a manager of the year in Brandon Hyde, and he's going to do everything he can to be better. You got Zach Eflin, who we talked about, is 3-0. You got Burns, who's a number one guy. You know, whether he'll re-sign here or not, there's another story. But I was talking to Brandon yesterday, and I said, okay, you won 101 games, and you got swept in the playoffs last year. The key is to get to the postseason. I don't, you know, the Yankees have a $315 million payroll. They have, you know, Soto hit three home runs in a game last night. Judge is going to win the MVP, having a remarkable season. They did lose Chisholm, who they traded for, I think, to an elbow injury. So I don't know if he'll play the rest of the year. But it's going to be a good race. Maybe it'll come down to the last week when the Orioles go to Yankee Stadium. You know, Ben McDonald, I think the three of us are going to do the games then, and then we're going to go to Minnesota to end the season. But if the Orioles can play 500 ball the rest of the year, well, they got another 42 games. That gives them, what, 91, 92 wins. If they play better than that, they'll be closer to 95 wins. And a lot of people are saying maybe there won't be a team in the American League that wins 95 games. Mm. But, again, it's nice to be in the position where you're in the race. You're tied in the loss column with the Yankees. You know, they have probably the best team on paper, but I've been around long enough to know that doesn't guarantee you're going to win games. So the Orioles are going to have to overachieve, but they're certainly capable of doing it. And back to your point, they know how to win. You know, 3 years ago, when you're winning 52 games and losing 110, you go, hey, well, you know what winning's like? And they go, not really. Yeah. You can't say that.
Right, right. Well, we certainly wish them the best and wish the health to the injured O's, because there are plenty of them. Jim Palmer, appreciate your time. And, again, happy anniversary to one of your last no-hitters. Unbelievable that to think back on that. So hopefully some of that can rub off on Grayson when he comes back from a back injury. Appreciate your time.
Yeah, I mean, that would be the big thing for him. And, you know, I'm sure they'll take it carefully. But, again, hopefully, as he said, it's maybe not as severe. I think he missed 2 or 3 months a couple of years ago when he was much younger. So hopefully he comes back and he's able to pitch up to his capabilities, because when he pitches, they usually win. He pitches great. They score him a lot of runs. Pretty good combination.
Indeed. All right. Hall of Famer Jim Palmer, an Orioles broadcaster. I think we're going to hear you again tonight on this conclusion of the Battle of the Beltways, right?
Exactly. And then the Red Sox. And then we go to New York to play the Mets. And then we come back here, a couple of national games, but Kevin Brown, Ben McDonald, I will be doing the Houston series. So
excellent. Well, looking forward to it. Thank you again for your time. Appreciate you. Again, thank you.
To play the Dodgers. So, you know, again, tough schedule. But, again, if you're playing well, you think you're going to win. And hopefully that will be the case with the O's.
Absolutely. Again, thanks a lot. That